You're familiar with the word mafia?
Yes, Mr. Watson.
There are allegations of phone hacking, computer hacking, conspiring to pervert the course of justice, perjury facing this company, and all this happened without your knowledge. Mr. Murdoch, you must be the first mafia boss in history who didn't know he was running a criminal enterprise.
Mr. Watson, please. I think that's inappropriate. Mr. Chairman.
برای درک عوامل مؤثر در شکل‌گیری محور قدرت رسانه در غرب، در این برنامه سعی می‌شود ابعاد دیگری را از رسوایی سال گذشته امپراتوری رسانه‌ای روپرت مرداک در انگلیس در دو سطح ملی و بین‌المللی بررسی کنیم. رسوایی سال گذشته رسانه مرداک که با برملا شدن نقش مدیران و عوامل خبری شرکت تحت مالکیت وی نیوز کورپوریشن در شنود تلفن همراه شهروندان انگلیسی، رشوه دادن به پلیس و اجیر کردن سیاستمداران انگلیسی همراه بود، فرصت مناسبی را مهیا کرد تا برخی از ابعاد پنهان روابط پیچیده و سازمان یافته قدرت و رسانه در این کشور طی مصاحبه‌های اختصاصی با دستاندرکاران رسانه‌ای و نیز چهره های نزدیک به مرداک مورد کنکاش قرار گیرد.
نتانیاهو I think liked him because he considered him to be a good introduction to meeting other people.
You basically don't pay a police officer in anything other than cash and not face to face.
It's an extraordinary coincidence that the same moment that the Murdoch papers go behind Cameron, that Cameron goes behind their commercial interest.
با بررسی شبکه ارتباطی رسانه‌ای مرداک با نخبگان قدرت به ویژه سیاستمداران و در رأس آن نخست وزیران انگلیس میتوان نقش این امپراتوری رسانه‌ای را در به اجرا درآمدن سیاست‌های چالشی و ماجراجویانه دولت در دو بعد داخلی و خارجی مطالعه کرد. بهره‌گیری فراقانونی از نیروی پلیس در داخل و استفاده ابزاری از مفاهیم حقوق بشر برای پیشبرد منافع کلان ملی به ویژه به کارگیری نیروهای نظامی در سطح بین الملل دو محور بحث در این برنامه هستند. دو قرن پیش رسالت رسانه‌ها در انگلیس چنین تعریف شده بود: روزنامه ارگانی نیست که دولت به وسیله آن بتواند افکار عمومی را کنترل کند، بلکه نهادی است که مردم از آن طریق دولت را تحت تأثیر قرار دهند. اما اصحاب رسانه در انگلیس معتقدند که این تعریف در دوره تونی بلر به پایین ترین سطح خود رسید، چنانکه وی از طریق عوامل مطبوعاتی خود به طور سازمان یافته‌ای افکار عمومی را با انتشار گزارش‌های کذب در موارد ویژه مانند توجیه آغاز تهاجم نظامی به عراق در سال 2003 میلادی گمراه کرد.
Tony Blair decided the moment he became leader of the Labour Party that he wanted the support of Rupert Murdoch. In fact, when he hired Alistair Campbell, his basically became his principal advisor and his press chief, they talked about little else than the need to secure the support of the Sun newspaper if Labour was going to win the 97 general elections.
اظهارات جسورانه پیتر مندلسون به عنوان محرم تونی بلر در دولت وقت نمونه ایست از دیدگاه حاکم بر ساختار سیاسی در انگلیس که منتقدان به آن استناد می کنند.
البته که ما می خواهیم از رسانه ها استفاده کنیم. رسانه ها ابزار و در خدمت ما هستند و ما دیگه به اونها اجازه نمی دیم ما رو آزار بدن.
با نگاهی به نظریه های روابط بین الملل در باب ارتباط سیاست خارجی با سیاست داخلی، می توان علل شکل گیری محور قدرت رسانه در غرب را با بررسی موردی ابعاد رسانه ی تهاجم نظامی به عراق از طریق رسانه های تحت مالکیت مرداک در داخل و نیز خارج از انگلیس بهتر درک کرد. سیاست خارجی گرچه در اصل تابعی از مفاهیم و ارزش های اجتماعی است، اما سیستم سیاسی در انگلیس مانند بسیاری دیگر از سیستم‌های سیاسی توانسته است زمینه توجیه سیاست‌های غیر منطقی خود را با استفاده از امکانات رسانه‌ای مرداک در دو سطح ملی و بین‌المللی پیگیری کند. برای نمونه در زمینه نقش مستقیم شخص مرداک در براه انداختن جنگ در عراق دیدگاه های متفاوتی وجود دارند. اما آنچه که مسلم است اتفاق نظری است که تحلیلگران درباره نقش رسانه‌های تحت نظر وی در سراسر دنیا در پیگیری و اجرای سیاست جنگ طلبانه تونی بلر در عراق دارند.
Blair's enthusiasm, which it was for war on Iraq in 2003, was matched by Murdoch's. They clearly spoke. Every single Murdoch newspaper in the world supported the Iraq war. It's a strange coincidence, as he insists that his editors usually have editorial independence, a marvelous unanimity, should we say, when so many other institutions were opposed to it.
Murdoch was one of the most powerful figures in media figures driving popular support, Fleet Street support for the Iraq war. And Murdoch, I believe, it is said that he spoke to Tony Blair several times on the eve of war. I think, in a way, he was close to Republican opinion in the United States of America. He was, I don't think it's too unkind or unfair to call him a warmonger. And the Murdoch papers, almost without exception, threw their weight behind the Iraq war. And they were part of the kind of drumbeat leading up the war.
It's not the first time that the media have played a role in supporting government policies and supporting wars. If you look at Murdoch supported every war of the last 30 years that the Americans or the British have been involved in, from the Falklands War, the First Gulf War and so on. But in 2003, when we found out from the recent Leveson inquiry, which is soon to release its report, that quite explicitly people like Alistair Campbell have revealed that Rupert Murdoch was on the phone to Tony Blair the week before the Commons vote to go to war, pressurising Blair over the timings of when the war would happen, and also you can see looking at just the headlines that the Sun published saying 45 minutes Brits 45 minutes from doom. Was perhaps their famous headline. This played a very big role in convincing significant sections of the public that the war was in their interest, that it was in the interest of national security.
روابط گوردن براون نخست وزیر سابق انگلیس از حزب کارگر با روپرت مرداک نمونه دیگری از نوع تعامل ابزاری نخبگان قدرت و رسانه در انگلیس می باشد. براون تا زمانی که از حمایت مرداک برخوردار بود مشکلی با او و یا اقدامات فراقانونی امپراتوری وی نداشت. اما پس از آشکار شدن این رسوایی، براون به عنوان یکی از قربانیان رسانه‌ای مرداک سعی کرد بر اساس اختلاف دیرینه‌ای که با وی داشت، خود را مخالف مرداک نشان دهد.
You threatened to declare war on News International or uttered words to that effect.
Yeah, this is the conversation that Mr. Murdoch says happened between him and me, that where I threatened him and where I'm alleged to have acted in an unbalanced way. This conversation never took place.
Gordon Brown is accused of being aggressive towards Murdoch. Murdoch is accused of attacking Brown and so on. What's quite interesting in this is this clash, only really materialised after Murdoch had switched to supporting the Tories. Where was the big tempestuous arguments publicly heard about whilst Blair was calling the shots? We didn't hear about it. We didn't really hear about it in 2009 and so on.
در این معادله توازن قوا را نه افکار عمومی بلکه سیاستگزاران و اصحاب رسانه به عنوان بازیگرین و ظهور در عرصه سیاست‌های بین‌الملل تعیین می‌کنند. اما قدرت نفوذ مرداک محدود به داخل انگلیس نبود و وی به منظور حفظ و توسعه قلمرو امپراتوری خود متوسل به هر سیاستی میشد. حمایت از عوامل قدرت در داخل و یا خارج از انگلیس، از حمایت‌های خبری، مالی و سیاسی گرفته تا برقراری ارتباطات نزدیک شخصی خود و یا مدیران ارشدش با نخبگان قدرت، از جمله ترفندهای وی برای حفظ منافع و نفوذ وافرش بوده است. برای نمونه، روابط بسیار نزدیک مرداک با رژیم صهیونیستی موجب باور عموم در یهودی بودن وی شده است و پوشش خبری یک جانبه رسانه‌های تحت مالکیت وی از رژیم صهیونیستی طی سال‌های متمادی چنین فرض نادرستی را در اذهان بسیاری شکل داده است. برای درک بهتر این ارتباطات به سراغ همدم مرداک رفتیم، خبرنگاری که با لباس سرخدمتکاری به تحقیق و تفحص بر روی وی پرداخت.
One day he said we have Mr. Netanyahu coming to stay, and I think it was the first time he'd ever been. And I said, who is Mr. Netanyahu? And he said, oh, he's the Israeli representative to the United Nations. And he's going to be the next prime minister. No doubt about that. He's going to be the next prime minister.
فیلیپ تاونسند از رازهای حائز اهمیتی برای ما پرده برداشت. صحبت‌هایی که برای نخستین بار بیان شده است.
Netanyahu used to ring up from Jerusalem and say, "I'm coming to stay." And he used to say, "Can you get me a car, please?" And so I called Murdoch's office, and the message came back. Murdoch says he can borrow Norman. Norman was Mr. Murdoch's driver. Very often, the question was, who will pay? And he used to say, oh, Rupert will.
در چنین بستر سیاسی این سوال مطرح می شود که با توجه به سیاست منفعت طلبی مرداک و این واقعیت که شبکه های تلویزیونی ماهواره‌ای وی با هزینه نسبتاً بالا در اختیار بینندگان غربی قرار می گیرند، هدف از راه اندازی دو شبکه تلویزیونی رایگان 24 ساعته به نام فارسیوان و زمزمه برای ایرانیان چه می تواند باشد؟
پدیدار می شود، زمان جشن گرفتن فرا می رسد و این گونه میهمانی خدا به پایان می رسد.
این دو شبکه بدون در نظر گرفتن اعتقادات دینی ایرانیان، اعم از مسلمان و یا غیر مسلمان، بسیاری از ارزش‌های معنوی، اخلاقی و خانوادگی را زیر پا گذاشتند.
This US-led Western imperialist block is trying to clamp down on Iranian TV channels in Europe. At the same time, this whole elite are backing this Farsi One channel, which is an attempt to inject the most crass and the most caricatured neoliberal Western values, so to speak, into a culture which they know full well is going to cause a big stir.
اما واقعا چرا دل مرداک به حال ایرانی ها سوخته؟
They wouldn't dream of doing it in Saudi Arabia, for example. They wouldn't dream of showing trashy American soaps in Saudi Arabia, which would obviously offend a lot of people's religious beliefs and so on. But they will do it in Iran because the neoliberal elite, the imperialist elite have been gunning for Iran for quite some time.
موضع‌گیری طرفداران رسانه‌های تحت نظر مرداک از پلیس اسکاتلند یارد انگلیس که به شکل‌های مختلف به ویژه انتشار اخبار مثبت نمود می‌یابد، زمینه مناسبی را برای پیشبرد اهداف مرداک فراهم آورده است. بر این اساس، زیر مجموعه امپراتوری رسانه‌ای روپرت مرداک همواره ضمن برخورداری از حمایت نخبگان قدرت، توانسته است با پشت سر گذاردن موانع قانونی به دلیل بهره‌مندی از سکوت و حمایت پلیس اسکاتلند یارد، بدون نگرانی از هر نوع پیگرد قانونی، به فعالیت فراقانونی و بدور از اخلاق حرفه‌ای خود ادامه دهد.
The relationship has always been double-headed, really, because on the one hand, the press are able to present the police in a good light, particularly in times of stress, in times of serious allegations of misconduct. If you've got the press on your side, you tend to get an easier ride than if the press are constantly badgering police misconduct. On the other hand, the press get the inside track on many serious crimes and many major incidents.
The conflict around Rupert Murdoch's Wapping plant has been going on for several.
برای درک این رابطه دو طرفه باید به ژانویه 1986 برگردیم، زمانی که تصمیم مرداک برای انتقال روزنامه‌های خود به واپینگ منجر به اخراج 6000 کارمند شرکت نیوز اینترنشنال شد. تنها یک ارتش خصوصی می توانست مرداک را از خشم اتحادیه های ناشران مسئول نگاه دارد.
You're surrounded by barbed wire, security gates, security men.
We had a very valuable installation here and we have to protect ourselves and we also particularly have to protect the people who are working for us.
There was clearly going to be public disorder by the old print workers and their unions having picket lines to prevent the finished product from leaving Wapping. And so Rupert Murdoch realised that he needed the backup of the police, first of all to minimise public disorder, and secondly to assist him in getting his product out onto the streets.
I've been sick with chickenpox from the 7th of January to the 31st. While I've been sick, I've got a letter, dear sir or madam, saying that I've been sacked. And for me to do that after we've earned in millions, and just to sack us just like that, the people are being as sick as sacked.
There were nightly battles as these the lorries were forcing their way through, and the police were battling with the pickets and so on to ensure that the lorries got through.
و این آغاز رابطه دوستانه میان مرداک و پلیس اسکاتلند یارد بود.
Over the years, they became so close that you couldn't see the line where one ended and the other began. I mean, it's pretty clear that people at the News of the World in particular, but also the Sun, were advising the Scotland Yard. People from Scotland Yard were, when they retired from their position as police officers, going to work for News International, write columns, give advice, whatever.
You've only got to look at the number of favours that the police were doing for senior and past members of News International and the other way around, and the number of favours that they were doing for police officers. All of that now has been exposed.
They were rather like with the politicians, lunching a bit too much. Police officers were accepting entertainment where they shouldn't have, and as it were, gifts of various kinds when they shouldn't have.
Dinners at top hotels, top restaurants, paid for stays in so-called health farms like Champneys. I mean, the bill runs up to an awful lot of money.
پنهانکاری پلیس در مورد خطاهای قانونی مدیران ارشد مرداک یکی دیگر از ابعاد بدبستان‌های پلیس با شبکه رسانه مرداک است که در قبال حمایت مالی و خبری از نیروهای انتظامی اسکاتلند یارد صورت می‌گرفته است. در جریان رسوایی استراق سمع تلفن‌های شهروندان انگلیسی توسط روزنامه‌نگاران که سال گذشته فاش شد، پلیس سال‌ها ابعاد این رسوایی را از رسانه‌ها و مردم پنهان کرد و تنها به یک نفر گزارش میداد.
Who did they tell? They told Rebecca Brooks.
ربکا بروکس در آن زمان مدیر اجرایی نیوز اینترنشنال و دست راست روپرت مرداک بود.
We know that within weeks of the arrests being made, they told Rebecca Brooks, a police officer still not named, rang Rebecca Brooks to tell her that hacking had been widespread at the News of the World, that there would be prosecutions, but she was reassured that the prosecutions would stop with the two people, the one rogue reporter and the private investigator. That for me is a bit like what you expect with the mafia.
You're familiar with the word mafia?
Yes, Mr. Watson.
There are allegations of phone hacking, computer hacking, conspiring to pervert the course of justice, perjury facing this company, and all this happened without your knowledge. Mr. Murdoch, you must be the first mafia boss in history who didn't know he was running a criminal enterprise.
Mr. Watson, please. I think that's inappropriate. Mr. Chairman.
این مافیای قدرت همینطور با ترفندهای نظیر سوژه سازی بر علیه افسران بلند پایه پلیس اسکاتلند یارد گستره نفوذ خود در میان این نهاد انتظامی را افزایش داده بود. البته میتوان گفت ایجاد یک رابطه حمایتی به تنهایی در بسیاری از موارد برطرف کننده نیازهای سردبیران روزنامه‌های مرداک بود.
This is what remains of the number 10 bus.
بهترین زمان برای نشان دادن حسن نیت نیوز اینترنشنال جهت تقویت این رابطه پس از حملات تروریستی 7 جولای 2005 در لندن بود. دو هفته بعد از این واقعه پلیس انگلیس به اشتباه یک جوان را به عنوان عامل تروریستی این حمله هدف گلوله قرار داد. اما جالب این بود که روزنامه‌های مرداک به اتفاق به حمایت از پلیس پرداختند.
Some of the news international papers tried to enhance that part of the story, the courage of the individual officers, and they also repeated what they'd been told by senior officers that he'd run when challenged. Well, he didn't run, and he was never challenged. In fact, he came down at a walking pace, picked up a free newspaper, was sitting on the train with the paper, reading the paper. There's no question of him running away or acting in any way which brought suspicion on him.
It would be their instinct in every circumstance where the police were under criticism to avoid criticism and to defend the police.
Can I not just ask whether they ever pay the police?
Sorry?
Just the one element of whether you ever pay the police for information.
Yeah.
We have paid the police for information in the past.
گاف بزرگ خانم بروکس در پاسخگویی به نمایندگان مجلس انگلیس در سال 2003 یکی دیگر از ابعاد پنهان رابطه پیچیده رسانه‌های مرداک و پلیس را فاش کرد.
We operate within the code and within the law, and if there's a clear public interest, then within the same holds for private detectives, for subterfuge, for video bags, whatever you want to talk about.
It's illegal for police officers to receive payments.
No, we don't. I just said within the law.
In a few years I was there, I think the figures were something like we paid £140,000 to various police officers. I think that was the figure. But basically not using a cheque, not using a credit card, anything to take... remove a police officer taking money would go to jail himself and lose his job, so he made it very difficult for anyone to find out that he got paid.
Police officers that were involved in accepting money were being corrupted by ex-police officers who were acting as liaison between the newspapers and, I mean, if you got someone like Paul McMullen, I mean, Paul, I doubt, would have been going out offering money to police officers that he didn't know. Somebody had to make the contact.
You basically don't pay a police officer in anything other than cash and not face to face. And there was a very roundabout route to disguise those payments. I've done, in my past, when I was just a reporter, I'd done a few stories that came from police contacts. So one that is quite well known is the Victoria Beckham one. We paid the close protection officer who was looking after her £30,000 in two carrier bags full of cash. Here's the money for the story. And it was the similar kind of money available for information on Princess Diana. I've always said that we didn't chase Diana to her death because we knew where she was going anyway, because we had the guys who looked after her, we paid them.
ارتباط فراقانونی نیروهای پلیس با رسانه‌های مرداک که در شکل‌های مختلف صورت گرفته، موجب وارد آمدن ضربه سخت حیثیتی به پلیس اسکاتلندیارد شده است. اما مسئله مهمتر در جامعه انگلیس خسارتی است که مردم متحمل شدند و آن بی‌اعتمادی به پلیس و رسانه به عنوان دو عامل امنیت و ثبات اجتماعی است.
The only people who suffer as a result of that long term wise will be the public, because the police will be less effective and the press will be less effective. It's going to take years for the Metropolitan Police to recover its credibility.
در آخرین قسمت از این برنامه سعی می شود به ابعاد رسوایی شنود تلفنی که به تازگی در سطح عمومی مطرح شد بپردازیم.
He should stand down. Cameron should resign. Do the honourable thing and say, well, let's have a fair election where I'm not backed by Murdoch.
همینطور آینده امپراتوری مرداک را با در نظر گرفتن نتایج تحقیقات اخیر قاضی لوسون مورد بحث و بررسی قرار خواهیم داد.